So, hello everyone. Welcome back to our YouTube live session that we are conducting every Saturday at 6 p.m. Antariksh is taking a lot of efforts to keep this thing going on for weeks. For today, I would like to welcome you all for today's talk. Today's talk is by a very eminent professor, Varun Bhalerao. He is an alumni of IIT Bombay. He completed his electrical engineering from IIT Bombay and got into Caltech to pursue his master's in astrophysics and completed his PhD in the same. His research interests include working on transits, supernova explosions, gamma ray burst as well. He is working on developing new techniques for instrumentation for ground-based optical telescopes and space-based X-ray telescopes as well. To add up to his recent works, he was a part of a team that built New Star, which was focusing on hard X-ray space observations, and later was in charge of ground calibrations for the CZT imager on AstroSat, which was India's flagship space exploration event. And his recent research also includes working on electromagnetic counterparts of the gravitational wave. So now I welcome him. And if you have any questions or doubts, you please put up in the chat box. We will have it in the end or even during the talk. I'll hand it over to you, sir.
I am Varun Bhalerao, and as I thank Rinmayi for introducing me so nicely. As she mentioned, I did electrical engineering at IIT Bombay and then switched to astrophysics. So what I do in my day-to-day research is I combine engineering with physics, with astrophysics, right? So my team and I, our collaborators, we build telescopes and satellites which are then used by us and by other astronomers in India and around the world for observing various things in the universe. So what you see next, I will take you in the next hour or so on a journey through the cosmos. Last week, you heard about gravitational waves, and you mainly heard about data analysis there and how gravitational waves are detected, how they are analyzed, what we learn from them. What we will do today is we will take the next step and we will say, okay, astronomy, we usually think of telescopes and optical telescopes and radio and X-ray telescopes. So how does that come into the picture with gravitational waves? So let us actually switch over to the presentation now. So what you are seeing on screen now is the telescope that was introduced to you just a little while ago. The dome that you see with light shining at the bottom is the dome of the 70 centimeter, 0.7 meter growth India telescope. Normally when we are working, of course, we don't want lights in the telescope dome. But this is a video which was taken throughout the night when we were installing the telescope. So you can see the beautiful Milky Way rising in the backdrop. This is at the Indian Astrophysical Observatory in Hanle, Ladakh. And we will hear more about this telescope later. So, in case some of you hadn't attended last week's talk, I'm going to start with a two-minute primer on gravitational waves. Gravitational waves are a consequence of Einstein's theory of relativity. They are usually thought of as ripples in space-time. So, if you have these two masses which are in space and which are orbiting each other, then those masses distort the space-time around them. This is usually shown as a 2D structure, which you can see here, but in reality, it is 3D, and gravity distorts space around it. So if an object which was here first now moves to this side, the distortion in space which was first present here now has to move here, and that creates gravitational waves. And these waves are actually observed by using these very large detectors. So this is a flyover of one of the LIGO detectors in the US. This is LIGO Hanford. And the LIGO India detector, which is going to come up in eastern Maharashtra, is going to be quite similar to this. So these are 2 4-kilometer long tunnels. You have laser beams which are emitted from the center and they get reflected from both the mirrors at the end. And from measuring the path to those end mirrors, we can actually discover gravitational waves or measure. Okay, so let's hope the audio issue has been resolved here. Let's talk about this again. So when we talk about any heavy objects that are moving and creating gravitational waves, the kind of sources that are detected by LIGO is something we'll talk about in a minute. But we are talking about typically the mass of the sun are tens of times heavier than the sun. And gravity, as you know, results from mass. So what gravitational waves are going to actually smaller than Mumbai. Okay, so a neutron star can be about 25 to 30 kilometers across. And if there is accretion happening, then they might actually be. So if they are sucking in matter from a star which is orbiting it or something like that, they could emit gravitational waves. Or if there are supernova explosions, they could emit bursts of gravitational waves. And my personal favorite, we have not seen any of that yet, is the blue box at the bottom, which is unknown sources. I mean, it would be amazing if the universe surprises us with something that nobody had predicted from any of the theories, because that is what would make things for everyone. Trying to figure out something new, trying to understand what makes the universe tick is exactly why everyone goes into research. The most common source that we have heard of, though, is the merging binaries, and they are of various types. So they could be two black holes merging with each other, or a black hole merging with a neutron star, or two neutron stars colliding with each other. And in this talk, I will mainly focus on this last category, which are two neutron stars which are colliding with each other. Okay, and several such explosions have been seen by now, so we will talk about some of those as well. So where does the astrophysics of all of this come in? Okay, or another way to think of it is, what is it that keeps me up at night? So as an astronomer, of course, everything keeps me up at night. But my research group, there are two main questions that we focus on. Okay, so the first is, where are all the heavy metals in the universe formed? Itata, astronomers count in a very different manner. So we have hydrogen, helium, and everything else. So as far as an astronomer is concerned, everything heavier than helium is a metal. So lithium, beryllium, but even carbon, nitrogen, oxygen. So don't try this in your chemistry class. It will not lead to good results. The second question that we explore is, what is the equation of state of ultra-dense matter? So let me try to explain these two questions a little bit. Okay, so you may have heard this very famous quote from Carl Sagan, which says that we are all made of stardust. So what is shown here is the periodic table of elements, but it is color-coded a bit differently from what you may have seen before. What the different colors are telling you is, how were the different elements created? So at the top, hydrogen and helium are in blue, which means that they were almost entirely created in the Big Bang itself. But then on the other hand, you see elements like oxygen, which are yellow, on a yellow background. These were created exploding massive stars. Okay, and the carbon and nitrogen on Earth, which is vital for life, most of it was actually made in dying low mass stars. So stars like the sun or lighter than the sun. And then at the bottom, you see a lot of purples. And that is, for example, that has a lot of interesting elements, by the way. You see that there is silver and gold here. There is platinum. So all of these exotic elements that we all like were actually created in the mergers of neutron stars. And it was just 2 years ago that we could finally prove this conclusively, that this is what was really happening. Okay, so how do you make gold, right? I presume sagyanna sona avadto. Tumhala jar banvayacha asla to kay karayla lagel? Well, you first start with creating a universe. Okay, and in that universe, you create giant stars from hydrogen. And once those stars are made, nuclear fusion starts inside those stars. And with nuclear fusion, you start generating helium and other heavier elements, which astronomers would call metals. Now, you have to, at the end of their lives, these stars explode as a supernova. In the core, otherwise they were just sitting inside the star. They are not any good for us. But then with the explosion, they spread them out throughout the space around. Okay, now from this, you actually form the next generation of stars. Okay, second generation stars. And with these second generation stars now, you actually again explode them. And now these kind of stars are such that at the end of their lives, when they explode, they can create neutron stars. So depending on how heavy the star is, it may create a neutron star or a black hole or something called a white dwarf. So the sun is a small star by standards of the universe, and it is not going to have a supernova explosion ever. All right, so let's keep track of our count here. We have created stars and killed them twice, but we are not yet done. We have still only made neutron stars. So now what you do is you collide those two neutron stars together, kill the poor thing a third time, and in the process you have created, as a little side effect of all of that, is where you have created some gold. Okay, and last time we saw this, you may have read some newspaper headlines in late 2017 when few times the mass of the Earth was how much gold was probably synthesized in this neutron star merger. Okay, the other point I said that we study is the equation of state. Equation of state is something some of you may have heard about in if you are studying physics or engineering, where this is something called the phase diagram of water. So equation of state tells you what is the relation between pressure, density and temperature. Okay, so what is shown here is that if I take water at atmospheric pressure, if it is very cold below 0 degrees Celsius, then it is ice. As the temperature increases, it melts and I get water. And at 100 degrees, it boils. On the other hand, if I start boiling, if I increase the pressure, as happens in a pressure cooker, then the boiling point goes to a higher temperature. So this is the phase diagram of water. This is a very simplistic version of equation of state. The ones which we are trying to study is what is happening inside the very nucleus of an atom. Right? Atoms make up everything. So we want to understand, it's a very, very important physics question, that we want to understand how atoms themselves exist, how they function, and how do they create everything that we see around us. So in order to understand this, we want to study the equation of state, but you can't quite do that very easily. Okay, so how would you study the equation of state of ultra-dense matter? Could you do some experiments for that? So the standard approach to that is in particle physics. So what you do is you take two particles, you collide them together, and you see what happens in the collision. Okay. Okay, and that's slow. So if you want to bump things up a little bit, you can collide bunches of particles like is done in the Large Hadron Collider. And it was like this that the Higgs boson was discovered, for instance, in the Large Hadron Collider. Okay, but come on, we are astronomers. You know? Bunches of particles, not good enough. We were just talking about black holes, universe, Big Bang. We want to do something on a larger scale. So what we will do is we will take these many particles, that's 3 followed by 57 zeros, and let's collide them together. That's more particles than exist on the entire Earth or in the entire solar system, actually. So what we are doing is there are two neutron stars. I cannot set up this experiment, but the universe can. So what you saw here is two neutron stars were orbiting each other, and as they orbit, let's play that video again. So two neutron stars are going around each other. What is shown in blue is artist's representation of gravitational waves. They are not light waves. They would not look blue. In fact, we can't see them at all. So they are just being shown in blue here. And as the neutron stars orbit each other, as they go closer, because they are losing energy by gravitational wave emission, and when they finally collided, we had this massive, massive explosion, which created debris around here. It launched jets. The jets then went into interstellar medium and slowed down. So this is a scientifically quite accurate rendering. This is an artist's rendering. Even the most powerful telescopes in the world do not see images directly like this, because this event was very, very far away. Okay, it was hundreds of millions, about 200 million light years away. So we can't see this directly. However, this is what we have pieced together from what happened. Okay, so this particular event is called GW170817. It stands for gravitational wave event in the year 2017, August, on 17th of August. So GW170817, here is the detection and discovery of it. So at the bottom, this graph that you see, which shows a blue line or a yellow-green line slowly going up here, that is called a chirp signal. And this is what was detected by gravitational wave detectors. So you could actually convert this into sound. You can see that this is audio frequency. So if you played this, it would sound like whoop. So by the way, this sound, when we say that gravitational waves are audio frequency, it's important to realize that actual awaz nahi hai. Okay, this is a very different kind of radiation, just as light and sound are very different kind of radiations, or waves on the sea are a different kind of radiation. So why am I comparing it to sound? Think of it when you talk on a phone. Okay, if you and I are having a phone call, or you are sitting and watching this probably over your phone's data or on Wi-Fi, okay, some radio waves actually came and hit your phone or your laptop. And those waves were then converted into sound by doing some processing by the device that you are holding. So the same thing is here. These are gravitational waves. They are detected by gravitational wave detectors, and then we can convert them into any other signal that we want. They happen to have the same frequency as audio frequencies. So typically up to a couple of kilohertz is what the ground-based gravitational wave detectors work in. And that is what we can convert and play as a sound. Okay, so then you have these three plots on the top. What is plotted here is how many X-rays or gamma rays were detected by different instruments on satellites as a function of time. Okay, and time here is in seconds. You have minus 10 seconds on the left side, zero here, marked by the black line is when the collision happened. And then plus 6 here is the right end. And you can see that after about 1.7 seconds after the merger, there's a spike seen by the integral satellite here and in two different bands of the Fermi satellite at the top here. Okay, so this event, the moment it was discovered in gravitational waves, very shortly thereafter, we actually detected in X-rays also. And that was a very big deal. So I had sent out a message to my students saying, this is a big deal, let's get to work. This is what we have waited for. We had been preparing for this for almost 3-4 years, waiting for this to happen. And in Jagbharat, baki thikani, loka tachar, 20, 30, 40 varsha kaam karot hote, just predicting these things, calculating what they would look like. So the moment this did happen, integral and Fermi detected that. The kind of burst that you see here is not very rare. Okay, for example, here is a plot from AstroSat CZTI. This is the cadmium zinc telluride imager, the instrument which I worked on. There are four independent instruments comprising CZTI. They are marked by ABCD here. And you can see four color light curves here. These are called light curves. And I can now play the time forward. So you can see that typically we were getting 100, 150 counts per second. And then suddenly you have this huge spike at the center where it crosses 2,500 counts. Okay, so these are called short gamma ray bursts. We have detected a couple of dozen of these with AstroSat, and there is a variant called long gamma ray bursts. So I just mentioned AstroSat, and AstroSat is India's own space. It's India's flagship space observatory. Okay, so it's a multi-wavelength satellite. It comprises of five different telescopes. So these three boxes at the top, these are called LAX-PC, Large Area X-ray Proportional Counter. This is what looks more like a conventional telescope, the ultraviolet imaging telescope. We have a soft X-ray telescope here. These three boxes, 1, 2, and 3 on the side, actually form the scanning sky monitor. And then this in the front is the instrument that I worked on. Note that these telescopes look quite different. Durbin mandlar je aplya dokyat eta tase disan nahi, and that's because a lot of these are not working in optical wavelengths. Just as dish antennas are radio telescopes, and they don't look like your usual optical telescope with lenses or mirrors. Similarly, these look very different. Okay, but AstroSat is extremely sensitive. We have detected more than 300 of these gamma ray bursts by now. A couple of dozen of the short ones, there's a related type called long ones. Here's a plot of some of them. So AstroSat is so good at detecting these gamma ray bursts. And then when LIGO saw this merger and Fermi and others had detected that, we immediately started thinking, yes, AstroSat must have seen this. And actually, we did a calculation. It should have been extremely bright in AstroSat. When we actually looked at data, there was nothing. And here is how we piece that together. So this green region here is where LIGO said the burst happened, and then finally it was localized to be in this very nice galaxy sitting in this part over here. Okay, but before that happened, Fermi said that it happened somewhere in the sky in this brown area. Okay, and the light circle that you see here, the gray circle, was the part which was hidden behind Earth as seen by AstroSat. Okay, so and this is actually a very important lesson in science. आम्ही ज्या डेटामध्ये बघितलं आम्हाला बर्स्ट दिसला नाही, बट वी आर सो कॉन्फिडंट अबाउट आवर इन्स्ट्रुमेंट दॅट वी सेड दॅट लुक इफ इट वॉज हॅपनिंग इन द राईट साईड, द लोअर राईट साईड ऑफ दिस GBM ब्लॉब. ओके, सो व्हॉट इज हॅपनिंग हिअर इज LIGO हॅज सीन इव्हेंट. LIGO सेज इट इज समवेअर देअर इन द स्काय. द स्मॉल ग्रीन एलिप्स केम लेटर. ऍट द टाइम वेन ऑल दिस अनालिसिस वॉज गोईंग ऑन, LIGO हॅड detected the event cleanly only in one detector, and data analysis was going on to figure out where the event actually came from. Okay, so LIGO said it has happened somewhere in the sky. Fermi pointed out this large blob in the sky saying it happened somewhere here, and we said no, it's not that entire area because we didn't see it. So what we are saying is it must have happened in the upper left side, because if it happened in the lower right, we would also have seen it. So this was actually part of a publication that we published in Science with all of these results. And then since then, LIGO had been operating since April of last year till it was shut down in March this year because of COVID-19 in observing run called O3. And a lot of events were actually discovered in that. By the way, all of this information is public. You can look at this URL down here. All events are listed there. Right now, LIGO is closed for upgrades, so you won't get anything. But otherwise, there are also apps that you can install on your phone where you'll get an alert anytime LIGO discovers an event. So the next observing run may begin in another year or so. And when that happens, you should make sure you have that app installed so that you can keep track of it. So here's a bunch of candidates that LIGO and Virgo collaboration announced. So we call, I'm part of the LIGO scientific collaboration as well. We call these candidates. What happens is as data comes in, we analyze it in real time. And we immediately alert all astronomers and anyone around the world saying that this is what we have seen. But then we continue our analysis. And then after a lot of analysis, for example, we were sure that this last candidate was a 100% clean event. There is no chance that it was a false alarm. And this paper was published recently. The ones marked in the red bands here, these were actually retracted because a quick analysis showed that there is something that could be interesting, but in a day or two, by the time we did a bit more detailed analysis, we realized that no, this is not a real event, it was a false alarm, so those were retracted. Okay, so just like 170817, a lot of people, including our collaboration, did a lot of searching, but unfortunately, we really did not find anything. So the optical or radio or X-ray emission is called a counterpart, and unfortunately, despite all of our searches, we did not find a counterpart. Again, this is part of science. So just today morning, we have actually submitted a very comprehensive paper saying what the non-detection of counterpart means, and tomorrow's archive postings will include that paper. Okay, so I talked about Fermi some slides ago, where Fermi is the satellite you see on the upper left in the screen. It's a NASA plus ESA mission telescope, which detected the first counterpart to a binary neutron star merger. The other main satellite that does this currently is the Neil Gerald Swift Observatory, which is a largely NASA mission. And these turns out are not quite sensitive enough to detect these bursts. And the reason is that when the sources, when LIGO's sensitivity is increasing, it can now detect sources which are further and further away. But as these sources are further away, the X-ray emission is going to look fainter and fainter. Okay, so based on this now, it means that when we go forward and the next observing run, O4, LIGO is going to be even more sensitive. We stand a very little chance of detecting any more of these counterparts because they're just going to be faint. So how do we fix that? How do we do better? So what we need is a telescope which has an order of magnitude higher sensitivity. So it has to be a larger telescope, lower noise, we have to better be able to figure out what part was background radiation and what really was the signal coming from the source. Then we also need a wide spectral band. It could emit in X-rays, it could emit in gamma rays. We want to make sure that no matter what the source is emitting, we should be able to detect it, we should be able to study it. And then we don't want to be in an astrosat-like scenario again, where we were ready, we were extremely sensitive, but we missed it because the source was behind Earth. So we want to make sure that we are looking everywhere all the time, which means that you can't do this with a single satellite, because if I have Earth here and the satellite is sitting on one side of Earth, events behind the Earth will remain hidden, which is what happened with the first source with AstroSat. So we need two satellites that are on opposite sides of Earth so that we can continuously cover the entire sky. Okay? And remember, order of magnitude higher sensitivity. We are talking about making satellites or needing satellites which are 10 times better than the current NASA and ESA satellites that are out there. And this is exactly what we have set about to do. So this is a concept here, proposal called Daksha. Daksha is a satellite mission that is going to look for these electromagnetic X-ray and gamma ray counterparts to gravitational wave sources. And this is a completely Indian mission. It is led by IIT Bombay, working very closely with TIFR, PRL, RRI, IUCA, and various ISRO centers. So Daksha will consist of two satellites, which will have three types of detectors. We will have low energy, medium, and high energy detectors. These medium energy detectors are very similar to what is being used in AstroSat CZTI. They're actually the same set of detectors. The low energy detectors that we used, some of them were used on Chandrayaan. They are still functional in the Chandrayaan 2 orbiter. And the high energy detectors also have been used by us in various missions in the past. We are improving on all these technologies. And by doing that, what we will attain is that so far, there has been exactly one detection of a binary neutron star. BNS means binary neutron star. So a binary neutron star merger that was seen in gravitational waves and also detected by X-ray or gamma ray space telescopes, there has been only one. And Daksha will be so sensitive that we will be able to detect dozens of these per year. And also the conventional gamma ray bursts, I showed you how AstroSat has discovered more than 300 of them in about 5 years. Daksha will detect more than 1,000 of them every single year. And we'll be able to figure out where they are on the sky. We will be the only mission that can get these, which allows us to figure out what exactly was happening there. Remember I said that light comes from the surface. So this is going to tell us the physics of what happened on the surface there. And it will also help us do hard X-ray polarimetry, something which is extremely rare. Whether these surface emissions, whatever we study, these are how we could infer in 170817, when we actually followed up and studied it in detail, we actually could prove that, yes, all these elements from the lanthanide series are really formed in these mergers. And then what will also happen is something quite interesting. So how do you look for something? Okay, suppose you are sitting in a forest and you are listening to sounds of birds. खूप पक्ष्यांचे जो वेगवेगळे आवाज येत असले आणि मी तुम्हाला सांगितलं की लिस्ट करा काय काय पक्षी ऐकू येतात, तर इट विल बी ट्रिकी. यू माइट नॉट बी एबल टू टेल मी एव्हरी सिंगल बर्ड साऊंड दॅट यू हर्ड. बट देन सपोज आय आस्क यू, डिड यू हिअर अ पॅरट अमॉंग दोज बर्ड्स? देन यू नो वॉट टाईप ऑफ साऊंड यू आर लुकिंग फॉर. अँड इफ आय टेल यू, डिड यू हिअर अ पॅरट राईट नाव? आय जस्ट हर्ड वन. Then you are, and I heard it from that side. Okay, that is narrowing down your search, and you will be able to tell me a lot more confidently about whether you heard that sound as well or not. Okay, so this can be mathematically proven. This works, and this is called lowering the threshold, lowering the false alarm rate, or lowering the detection statistics. So what can happen is, with all these dozens of binary neutron star mergers that are detected by Daksha, if we detected the signal, we can tell the gravitational wave detector network, you look for a signal at exactly 12:10 today, and it must have come from this part of the sky. So that allows them to search far more sensitively, and that can actually increase the rate of detections by LIGO itself. And if you think of it, it is quite amazing. A completely different technology that is studying high energy radiation, X-rays and gamma rays, is helping to analyze gravitational wave data in a different way such that you can detect next events. And then, of course, finally, there's a huge discovery space. We are talking about building satellites which are 10 times more sensitive than anything else flown before. So there will be things that we will see that nobody has discovered yet. Nobody has probably even imagined them yet. So what's the current status? As I said, we are working with several institutes. I've actually small mistake here. Somehow RRI has been lost from this slide. Raman Research Institute in Bangalore. There are several teams which are active, and we have been given seed funding by ISRO to demonstrate a proof of concept. If that gets done, then ISRO will evaluate the proposal and decide whether the mission is to be launched or not. Okay, so Daksha is about space. So let's now come back down to ground. I showed you a telescope right at the start of my talk with the gorgeous Milky Way rising behind it. That is the GROWTH India Telescope based in Ladakh. GROWTH actually is a short form. It stands for Global Relay of Observatories Watching Transients Happen. So if you thought that SHIELD or HYDRA from Marvel were the most complicated short forms you have ever heard, think again. Astronomers can do one better. Okay, so the GROWTH network is actually a set of telescopes distributed all over the world. It's a network with 8 different, like a relay race. So we hand off this target from one telescope to another. So our discoveries are mainly done with the Zicky Transient Facility located at Palomar in California. After that, we pass on to observatories in Hawaii, then Japan, Taiwan, India, Israel, and then to telescopes in the Canary Islands, just off the coast of Africa. So as a part of this, we decided to set up a completely new telescope, and this is the GROWTH India Telescope. Before I go to the telescope, the GROWTH network is one of the most prolific networks around the world. We are at the very forefront of discoveries in and gravitational wave work. So for this single event, for example, we've published 15 publications. So when you do research, you have good results. They are actually sent to scientific journals. Other scientists come and cross-check all of your work, and only if everything is found to be correct, then it is published. So we published 15 papers, including 5 papers in the 2 most prestigious research journals that exist, Nature and Science. We did a lot of things. We actually had theoretical models which were proved by this. We could disprove some other theoretical models. We confirmed this R process nucleosynthesis. So we confirmed that gold and platinum and other elements were actually formed there. So this has been a phenomenal success by having scientists all across the world. And this is a very important factor in science today, that today's science is global. We are at a scale where people from all over the world work together and pool all of the resources together, and only then can you actually make cutting-edge discoveries at the forefront of science. So even in the ongoing run, we have submitted a lot of different papers, and as I said, our summary paper of all of this was submitted yesterday, and it will be available online. Was submitted today morning, not even yesterday, and it will be available online tomorrow. Meanwhile, here's the GROWTH India Telescope. It's a fully robotic telescope. It has a 70-centimeter aperture, and it has a 4K by 4K CCD. By the way, what is this 4K by 4K? It means that my camera is 4,000 by 4,000 pixels. Now, that's 16 megapixels. Maybe some of you are actually having phones that have higher megapixels than that. But your phones probably cost in the range of tens of thousands of rupees. This camera costs more than 1 crore rupees. And why is that? Why am I not putting a 20, 30 megapixel cell phone camera there? And that is because this camera is far, far, far more sensitive than any of the cameras that we use. Okay, so just number of megapixels is not what the competition is around. The quality of data that you can obtain from a very high-end camera is what makes all the difference. Now, this telescope and camera, we have gone a long time without looking at pretty pictures. So here's a daytime picture of the same site. This is a summit called Dibga Rasta Ray in Ladakh, in Hanle, just about 50 kilometers from the China border. Here's the telescope dome. The automation of this telescope, all the programming was done largely by undergraduate students in close coordination with PhD students and postdocs. Now, at IIT Bombay, there's a PhD student and a few undergraduates who actually do all of this. And initial work was started by students from ISER Pune and then carried over to IIT Bombay. Okay, so and these are students from engineering and from physics backgrounds. So here's the telescope itself. Here's an image at night, very similar to the movie that you saw at the start. That movie was taken by postdoc Shubham Srivastav. Enough pictures of the telescope. Let's see some pictures taken by the telescope. Oh, here's the telescope sitting snugly inside the dome. This is a daytime picture, of course. Here's a Messier M11 called the White Duck Cluster. This is an image taken on the first light. So when we first switched on the telescope, after commissioning. Here is the Omega Nebula M17. Here's a more popular image, the Pillars of Creation, Eagle Nebula. You may have seen a yellow and blue version of this. And this is a very famous Hubble Space Telescope image. But this, of course, is an image taken from our telescope. By the way, these are raw images, completely unprocessed. So you can see there is a horizontal line here in the middle of the screen. There's a vertical line for those of you with sharp eyesight. These are all features that get completely cleaned up when we do some processing of the images. This has to do with the architecture of the camera and how it reads out the image. Okay, so Growth India Telescope is not the only Indian telescope that worked on this. Astrosat, as we saw, of course, worked on this. So here's a map showing all the professional telescopes around the country. Let's start with the green hexagons here. We have GMRT, which is the world's largest low-frequency radio telescope. This is situated halfway between Pune and Nashik, near Narayangaon. Then there is Gauri Bidanur and OT radio telescopes. These are all working in radio. Then what you see in red circles here are optical telescopes. We don't realize it. India madhe khup vegvegle research telescopes are spread all over the country. We have a lot of assets. So very productive right now are the 2-meter Himalayan Chandra telescope and the Growth India telescope. 3.6 meter is currently Asia's largest telescope now. That was just recently commissioned in Aries. So this is actually situated near Nainital on a mountain called Devasthal. And then there is a new 4-meter telescope coming up in Mount Abu. There's the 2.3 meter Venugappu and 1 meter and a 1.3 meter in Kavlur. There's Ayuka Giravli Observatory and so on. Astrosat is in space, not in Afghanistan, but I didn't know how to show space here. And then we also, India has partnership in the 10-meter Southern African Large Telescope located in South Africa. We are 10% partners in the 30-meter telescope. And a lot of these telescopes which exist here have contributed in the follow-up of gravitational wave sources and in the study of gravitational wave sources. Here's GMRT. A lot of great work was done for 170817 studies, that first binary neutron star merger that we saw. GMRT ला तुम्हाला आता of course lockdown चालू आहे पण नंतर visits असतात GMRT चे regularly, so you can see, you can contact people at NCRA and figure out how you can go there if you want to go there. And none of this is possible without having a good team. Okay, so here's a picture of our team at IIT Bombay. Slightly old picture, but here you have one postdoctoral fellow. He is the one who made that movie. You have two PhD students. This one is Harsh. He works on a lot of that automation now. Here's another PhD student, Gaurav. And then a lot of these students here are BSc or BTech and MSc students who were working on all of this work. And then at the bottom here is our international collaboration. You see people of different ethnicities and regions here, of course, all over the world. This is the international growth team. This picture was taken at one of the conferences. And it is these teams which have been working very hard to make all of this research possible. Okay. So when I was talking to the Antariksh group about today's talk, they said that a lot of the audience members are actually students at different stages of their careers. And we should also talk about career options in astronomy. Ratha, let's spend some 5-10 minutes talking about astronomy career options. All right, so let's start with a list of all the major astronomy institutes in the country. Okay, so there is Ayuka in Pune and NCRA in Pune, National Center for Radio Astrophysics. In Mumbai, there is Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. There is also Center for Basic Sciences and of course IIT Bombay. In Pune, another center is ICER Pune. Then there are a few centers in Bangalore, the Indian Institute of Astrophysics, Raman Research Institute, and the Indian Institute of Sciences. There is Physical Research Laboratory in Ahmedabad, ARIES in Nainital, S.N. Bose Center for Basic Sciences in Kolkata. And then a lot of the ISERs and IITs also have astronomy now. So IIT Jodhpur has a space science department. IIT Indore has a department of astronomy and astrophysics. ISER Kolkata, ISER Mohali, ISER Pune, ISER Trivandrum, all of these places have astronomers in them. Several of the IITs also have astronomers. IIT Gandhinagar, IIT Bombay, IIT Kanpur. And then, of course, there are a lot of universities. Pune University, Mumbai University included among them. Also, SRTM in Nanded, for example. Okay, so astronomy research is carried on at a lot of different places around the country. If you want to do astronomy research, how do you go about it? So the conventional path that you take is that you start with a 12th standard science course, so including maths and physics. Then you go for a BSc in physics or in astronomy. Bharatat far tharavik thikanis astronomy madhe BSc degree ahe kiwa MSc degree. Jasti karun loka he physics background madhe aata. So you do BSc physics followed by MSc physics, and then you go for your PhD. This is the default path. There are alternatives. For example, several places offer an integrated MS PhD. I did an integrated MS PhD after my engineering degree. So it's a joint program. So do is that you could start with a BE or a BTech engineering degree and then come back and do a master's followed by a PhD. You'll notice that this is drawn with a dashed line. So while this is possible, it is not recommended. आणि त्याचं कारण खूप सोपं आहे. ॲज अन ॲस्ट्रॉनॉमर 90-95% ऑफ द ॲस्ट्रॉनॉमर्स आर डोंट ॲक्च्युली रिक्वायर इंजिनिअरिंग बॅकग्राऊंड, बट 100% ऑफ द ॲस्ट्रॉनॉमर्स रिक्वायर अ फिजिक्स बॅकग्राऊंड. सो वेन यू आर डुईंग अ बी ई ऑर अ बी टेक, यू आर लर्निंग व्हेरी स्पेशलाइज्ड इंजिनिअरिंग स्किल्स, बट यू अदर्स हू वॉन्ट टू बी ॲस्ट्रॉनॉमर्स ॲट द सेम टाइम दे आर स्टडिंग फिजिक्स, आणि त्यांनी जे फिजिक्स शिकलंय ते तुम्हाला नंतर जास्ती कष्ट करून कॅचअप करायला लागतं. So it is possible, but it is difficult. For example, if you want to become a cricketer, you are not going to start your career by playing badminton. Okay, it is possible for a badminton player to become a cricketer, but it would be much better off if you started off with cricket directly. So if you want to become an astronomer, start off with a degree in physics. Okay, PhD झाल्यानंतर पुढे काय? Oh yeah, and of course, just as you can go for integrated MS PhD after your BSc, the same is possible after your BE or a BTech degree as well. So yeah, so after a PhD, you usually go into a phase called postdoctoral research. My guides had told me when I was PhD that this is the best part of your career. And having finished my postdoc and now that I am a faculty member myself, I believe that completely. I completely agree with that. That is where you have mastered the field and then you have the full freedom to do whatever you want. In the conventional path after that, you jala apan scientist manto is either a university professor or a research faculty. So a university professor would be someone who is in, say, Pune University, Mumbai University. A research faculty is someone working at, say, TIFR or IUCA or IIT Bombay, where we take students. IIT is sitting somewhere between university and research faculty. This is a continuous scale. Every astronomer, every scientist out there does a little bit of teaching and a little bit of research. As you go to universities, the teaching component increases and the research component goes down. Current divasat tevdes tas astat. IITs and ISERs sit somewhere in between. TIFR and IUCA and so on, you largely spend your time doing research and you spend some time teaching, either in PhD courses or to your students or teaching in master's courses and so on. And then a part which is not quite as common in astronomy careers in India is a research scientist. So if you have heard of places like CSIR labs or NCL and so on, that is where scientists are doing pure research, no teaching at all. पण इंडियन ॲस्ट्रॉनॉमी मध्ये दोज पोझिशन्स आर नॉट व्हेरी कॉमन. ॲट एनी पॉइंट हिअर इमिजिएटली आफ्टर युअर PhD ऑर आफ्टर युअर पोस्ट डॉक्टरल रिसर्च यू कॅन गो डायरेक्टली इन टू फुल्ली टीचिंग पोझिशन्स. So at some point, if you decide ki you like teaching more, then that is a very, very good option that you can go into. It doesn't necessarily have to go into research completely. And again, places like Ayuka enable you to, even if you are teaching in a college position, you are still completely welcome to come back into research. A lot of people are working very hard to make sure that is possible. And then another option is that after your PhD in astrophysics or after postdoctoral experience, you can still go into industry. I know a lot of people in industry who have come with a PhD, and I know several astronomers who have actually moved from astronomy into various jobs in, for example, software or even in robotics or in various kinds of areas. Okay, one of my friends, for example, after doing a PhD on LIGO, went and joined Facebook, and then he did biophysics in between. He had his own company in between. So a lot of different types of things are possible. Then I come to the final few slides. What can I do right now? We are in the middle of a pandemic. We are all at home trying our best to do what is possible. So if you are keen about learning and doing things right now, if you want to be a scientist right now, tumhi aaj kay karu shakta. First and foremost, remember that everybody has to have scientific temper. Okay, this is actually one of the fundamental duties as listed in the Constitution of India, Part 4A, Article 51A. It says it shall be the duty of every citizen of India to develop scientific temper. Okay, and in the spirit of this scientific temper, you should my statements at face value. Here's a link on the official government website of the full Constitution. Constitution, it turns out, is a rather small book, by the way, and you should go read it to make sure that this is true. Why is this important? It is the year 2020. We have successfully gone to Mars in our first attempt, and we are trying to launch yet another lander to go and land on the moon. But we are still surrounded by people who are thinking that coronavirus started because of a solar eclipse last year and will be finished in the solar eclipse that we have tomorrow. We still live among people who think it is not safe to eat during a solar eclipse. Okay, so there is unscientific things all around us which are holding back everyone. And as a citizen of the country, it is one of everyone's duties to make sure that we think and analyze everything that we see around us and we approach everything scientifically. Once you have the right kind of scientific temper, if you now want to go into astrophysics, first I would simply suggest start with astronomy picture of the day. Every day they show you a nice new pretty picture. Roz nidan ek chhan chitra vagara milta astronomy club, and it comes with a small explanation below. This explanation is meant to be accessible to anyone. Okay, so even if you do not have a science background, if you are someone from a completely unrelated field, tumhi ite jaun vachu shakta, tumhala hi kalel. If you are a student who is interested in astronomy, what you can do is you can follow the links given in that description, or any new words that you find which you don't know, go read up about them. Wikipedia is excellent for a lot of these things. Next, if you want to up your game a little bit, the next point is AstroBytes. So every day in astronomy, there are 60 or 70 new research papers published every single day. Even for a professional astronomer, it track of all of these. If you are a BSc student, it will take several days to completely understand a research paper, because it is written for an advanced audience. So what is done is that AstroBytes is a blog which is written by PhD students all over the world. Every week, they take 2-3 new interesting research discoveries that were announced that week, and they write a blog post which explains that discovery in simple words, and it also gives you the background and context. Ki hi discovery mahatvachi kay ahe, hindi navin kay kele, purvi kay maiti hota. So AstroBytes is a must read for anyone who is wanting to get serious about astronomy. There is another important point here. Tumhi astronomies are hausini documentaries bagat asla. Sir, you will hear about time travel, wormholes, and things like that if you are watching Discovery and Nat Geo and so on. Out of all the professional astronomers I know, nobody works on wormholes. Okay, so trying to form an idea about latest astronomy and astrophysics research by looking at only documentaries is like trying to get an idea about college life by watching Karan Johar movies. So if you are not doing the latter, don't do the former either. Astrobytes is where they're actually talking about latest research. So that will also give you a very nice idea of what is the current research areas that are active around the world. There are a lot of online courses that you can take, not just in astrophysics, but also in physics. Coursera has some very nice courses. There's one called Evolving Universe, which is a Caltech course. There's one called Data-Driven Astronomy, which is from one of the growth collaborators in Sydney. All of these courses can be taken for free, by the way. Coursera first will ask you to pay some 2,000 rupees to sign up. That's only if you want a certificate, but free courses are available. They're all quite good. If you want to get hands-on, then there is a lot of publicly available data with tools for doing analysis. So LIGO, since we are talking about gravitational waves in this talk, there's a LIGO Open Science Center. You can search these things online and you'll find the links. The Growth Collaboration holds summer school, the data-driven astronomy course that I talked about. Speaking of growth summer schools, by the way, registration is open right now for the 2020 growth summer school. आपल्याकडे पावसाळा सुरू झाला असला तरी इतर ठिकाणी अजून उन्हाळा चालू आहे. सो दिस इज स्टिल कॉल्ड अ समर स्कूल, ऑल्दो इट इज बीइंग हेल्ड इन ऑगस्ट. रिमेंबर दॅट द समर सॉल्स्टिस इज हॅपनिंग अराउंड नाव, सो इट इज द पीक ऑफ समर टेक्निकली राईट नाव. सो दिस इव्हेंट इज कम्प्लिटली ऑनलाइन. वी ऑलरेडी हॅव सम 650 ऍप्लिकेशन्स, विल सिलेक्ट क्लोज टू 100 पीपल होपफुली इन दिस. And you can sign up for this. If you get selected, then in August you'll be able to attend this. If you can't, if you don't get selected or if you can't attend in this session, that's still okay. Material from the last 2 years is all available online. This is meant for advanced students, by the way. So we assume that you have basic astronomy knowledge. We assume that you know a little bit of programming. So if you fall into that category, then you should sign up for this school. All right, so I will end with that. This is overall a fantastic time to become an astronomer. A lot of interesting discoveries are happening around the world. India is at the forefront of this, joining shoulder to shoulder with other people. So come on, come join the ride. I'll end with that. Thank you.
Yes, sir, this was definitely a great session. We have a lot of questions that I would like to ask you. The first question is by Dhananjay Kapse. He's asking, as you said, LIGO mostly detects gravitational waves in kilohertz. How does other gravitational wave spectrum look like with sources, as we see in electromagnetic spectrum?
Okay, so Dhananjay, let me see if I understood your question correctly. What you are saying is that LIGO is detecting certain types of sources which emit. So LIGO works all the way down to about 20 hertz or 10 hertz. So this is where we see binary neutron stars, binary black holes. We may see supernovae. These are the primary sources here. If you go to lower frequencies, then we can't actually detect those from the ground, because below 10 hertz, the Earth vibrates a lot. ओके आपण आता गणपतीची तयारी सुरू झाल्यावर ढोल ताशे पथकं सुरू झाली की इवन यू कॅन फील दोज थिंग्स अराउंड यू, राईट? इफ देअर इज अ ट्रक ड्रायव्हिंग पास्ट ऑर इफ देअर इज अ गुड ड्रम प्लेईंग नेक्स्ट टू यू, यू फील द व्हायब्रेशन्स अँड ऑल ऑफ दॅट अफेक्ट्स द मेजरमेंट. सो फॉर लोअर फ्रिक्वेन्सीज देर आर स्पेस बेस्ड डिटेक्टर्स दॅट हॅव बीन प्रपोज्ड, वन कॉल्ड लिसा फॉर एक्झाम्पल. अँड लिसा विल ऍक्च्युली वर्क ॲट मिलीहर्ट्स फ्रिक्वेन्सीज. इट विल बी एबल टू डिटेक्ट supermassive binary black holes, so black holes which are million to billion times heavier than the sun, or it will be able to detect merging white dwarfs. On the other hand, at even lower frequencies, we will be able to see what are called primordial gravitational waves that have originated directly from the Big Bang. So that's the entire spectrum of gravitational waves that can be seen.
Yes, of course, there was a talk on primordial black holes, the first talk which was organized by Antariksh. You can definitely refer that. Moving on to the next question. Next question is by Vaishali Kasture. She's asking, how does expanding space affect the gravitational waves?
Vaishali, that's a good question. As space expands, every kind of radiation that is going through also expands because of that. So the wavelength actually increases. So this is called gravitational redshift, or rather cosmological redshift to be more precise. and that does affect gravitational waves. It is not a very big effect for the current sensitivity of LIGO because we, relatively speaking, we see things that are very close by on the cosmic scale. But as the sensitivity of LIGO increases, we will be able to see sources further and further away, and we will see them redshifted to longer wavelengths or to lower frequencies. So that effect has to be accounted for in gravitational wave data analysis.
I guess the question is answered. The next question is by Astro Explorer. He's asking how gravitational waves are classified. How are those classified? Is it by a binary black hole or neutron star merger or any unknown source?
Okay, so Astro Explorer, that's an interesting name to have. I'm guessing your actual name is different, but let's call you Astro Explorer. So I guess what you're asking is, how do we know what the gravitational waves came from? And the way we know what they came, analyzing the waveform. So think of it this way. I gave you an example about birds. How do you know which bird made a particular sound? And the way you know is that you know what different birds sound like. So for gravitational wave sources as well, there have been very detailed calculations done about what kind of signal you would expect from the merger of black holes, what kind of signal you would expect from the merger of neutron stars. And the way the search is done is by looking for those particular signals in the data. Okay, technically this is called matched filtering. And by doing this matched filtering is how we find out what kind of sources were present in the data. There are also other types of sources called burst sources where we wouldn't exactly be able to figure out what caused the emission, but we haven't detected any source of that type just yet. No confirmed detection of that sort. I hope that answers your question.
Yes, sir. The next question is by Nishant Pawar. He's asking how uniquely we identify EM counterparts are from gravitational wave sources and not any other sources.
That is a very nice question. Let's see if I have the right slide for this. So let's see. Give me just one moment, okay? There were actually three which we needed to put together to figure out if the source was gravitational wave source or not. Okay, so first thing that we detected was this gravitational wave signal itself. Second thing we detected was this explosion in X-rays and gamma rays. And the third thing we detected was this nice picture which was seen in other slides here. So these are the first six telescopes that imaged the source. We are used to thinking of pretty pictures in astronomy, by the way, but see here, you can nicely see a galaxy and a source which is present here, which wasn't seen the day before, for instance. But sometimes images can also be like this, where you need to do detailed image processing to figure out that the source is really seen here. So how did we link these three sources? Well, to link the X-ray gamma ray emission with the gravitational waves, we argued as follows. We see roughly one gamma ray explosion in the sky per day. Before the event happened, we had already defined that we would want what is the theoretical difference in arrival times that is possible. How soon before or after a gravitational wave can you expect the electromagnetic emission to come in high energies? And that window was fixed to be about 1,000 seconds. So the chance of randomly seeing these two at the same time is only about 1 in 1,000, roughly. The second thing is that, okay, suppose there was an unrelated VRB, what are the odds that it will happen in the same part of the sky as the gravitational wave signal? And those odds, again, are about 1 part in 1,000. Okay, so, by the way, are you seeing my shared screen just now? Because I had exited the shared screen, so I just want to make sure. Okay. So the total odds of these two being together are only about 1 in 1,000,000. That's how we know that they were related. And then when this particular source was found in optical, we again had to make sure that this is indeed related to the other two. So the same argument again, it was in the right part of the sky. And the properties of this, how its brightness changed over time, what its spectra looked like, very nicely matched our theoretical predictions for what should have been expected there. So that is how we could be sure. This is called false positive or false alarm rate, which has to be made very, very low in order to make sure that we are getting only true positives like this particular detection.
That was very insightful. The next question that I would like to ask is there any chance we get gravitational waves from GRBs?
That is a very interesting question. Can you say who asked it? Anyway, so remember at the start, I said that there are two types of gamma ray bursts. There are short GRBs and long GRBs. So, and I showed you this particular short gamma ray burst. These last for about 1 or 2 seconds or less than that. Long GRBs last for tens to hundreds of seconds. Short GRBs are actually believed to be or were theoretically not, believe is a very weak word. Okay, the theoretical prediction said that short GRBs are a result of the merger of two neutron stars. All right, so yes, we can see GRBs from merging neutron stars. We have seen a lot of them. In this animation here, remember that the merger itself, when it happened, it actually launched a jet which was perpendicular to the orbit. Okay, so if you happen to be along the line of sight, if you were sitting somewhere here, then you would see this jet coming directly towards you, and that would have been a short gamma ray burst. Whereas we were observing it from the side, roughly at an angle of about 20-25 degrees is what was measured. And that is why we didn't see the GRB itself, we saw a fainter burst in gamma rays.
Okay. The next question is by Parth Tulsapurkar. He's asking, how does the X-ray spike look in a black hole merger, and how does it differ from the spike of a neutron star merger? About the representation of spike.
Okay, so black holes are called black because they don't emit any light, which means that if two black holes merge, you don't expect to see any radiation from that at all. And indeed, despite a lot of searching, we want to be careful. We want to make sure nature is not surprising us with anything. And there is no emission that we see from the merger of black holes. We only detect them in gravitational waves. On the other hand, if there's a merger of a black hole with a neutron star, we may see something. It depends on how large the black hole is as compared to the, how heavy it is as compared to the neutron star. There is a lot of argument within the scientific community right now about what kind of X-ray spike might be seen in that. So once the first discovery happens, we will be able to say confidently about what happened. Next question.
Yeah, definitely. The next question is by Raj S. He wants to know, does we encounter biasing while determining the gravitational waves? If so, how are they reduced?
Raj, that is a generic question. I didn't fully understand it. So in any type of scientific analysis, there is always a possibility of bias. And the way you address bias is by being very careful about what. So what kind of assumptions are going into your analysis. For gravitational wave analysis, there are several independent teams within the collaboration that have written analysis software. Almost all the software is open source, so it is available for anyone. Any scientist, non-scientist around the world can actually go and download the software and check how the analysis is being done. A lot of independent checks and measures that come into place to make sure that we are not biased towards any particular other is as follows. Gravitational waves come from concentrated masses that are interacting with each other.
Best of our knowledge, there are two stars completely attachment.
Yes, sir. This is the last question by Akshata Saraswat. She is asking, is it possible to predict the relativistic mass of a neutron star in a binary system just before merging? Just before merging. Hello, yes sir, this session, I guess most of the questions are answered. Yeah, can you hear me? Yes, most of the questions are answered, and it was a really great session, very interactive and humorous at the same time. The careers part was really very important for today's youth, as we are looking out for opportunities all the time. And if we have any more questions or doubt, we would mail you. And I really thank you for being a part of Antariksh and enlightening students in these situations as well.